Crossfire World Outreach Ministries invites you to join our weekly online prayer service on Tuesdays. From 10:30 a.m. to noon, you can connect with people locally and around the world to pray for each other. The prayer service streams live on Facebook, YouTube, and on our website, www.mycrossfire.com. Coming up on Crossfire TV.
It's no longer I that lives, but Christ who lives in me. My hope is in Christ. My future is in Christ. You say, well, I don't know if that's healthy. Well, I'll tell you what. Without Christ, everything I do is as filthy rags. My past, folks, is behind me. Every day I put my past behind me. I'm not going to look back. Welcome to Crossfire Television, and I apologize in advance for my voice. We've been going and going and going and going, but I got a little bit of voice left, and I'm so grateful to be able to bring this message on baptism to you, and the baptism after baptism after baptism. A few weeks ago, we did baptisms. We got baptism scheduled coming up. It's been exciting to see so many people coming to Jesus, knowing and learning and being discipled in the things of God. Today, the message is more than just on baptism, but it's understanding what baptism really means and really is. Many people got baptized, but it didn't mean anything when they did it. And there are some who have never been baptized. They didn't see any purpose or value in it. So today we're going to talk about baptism and what it is to walk in a cleansing confession of your faith. And are you actually cleansed by baptism? Is it just a symbol? What does the Bible say about it? What does it mean? So we're going to talk about those things. But the best part is the testimonies of changed lives, the testimonies of things that God has done, the testimony of changed lives of peoples whose very lives were radically changed because of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I know you'll enjoy not only the message and the teaching, but you're going to enjoy the baptisms and the testimonies of the people whose lives are changed. And I know it'll be a life-changing event for you. I also want to encourage you, come check out Crossfire Church, Crossfire Healing House. It is a true place of healing and of love and acceptance, at the same time holding a standard to who God is, what God's about, what His Word says. We don't get to make up the rules. God, our Creator, has made up the rule of what is good and what is not good for our lives. So I want to encourage you, listen today, see what God's going to do and say in your life, and maybe it's time for you to decide to be baptized. But I got to start with a letter. You ready for this letter? I'm not sure I am. So last week, we had a great day at Easter. God did some great things, saw some lives change, had some kids have a lot of fun. And I'm just going to tell you, I get a lot of letters. Not all of them are good. We had a number of people walk out of the service mad. I'm used to that. It's not a badge of honor. My heart breaks when that happens. But I will tell you this. We're going to do what God tells us to do. More than importantly, we're going to do what the Word of God tells us to do. We don't get to go by people's opinion. We got to go by what God's word says. Now, if I do something that's outside of God's word, write me, tell me, call me. I got a letter. It says, "Greetings to you. I have visited the Springfield sanctuary," and I'm leaving this completely anonymous, "a number of times, and most recently on Resurrection Sunday. I had with me a child, and she really liked Kids Church and the egg hunt. Thank you so much for including the community. I have really appreciated the feeling, the welcome, that Crossfire, and I am considering increasing my church attendance." So far, it's great. Praise Jesus. I'd like to get one of these letters from all of you. It'd actually be very encouraging. "Yet," that's where it changes, "I have a concern, please. I am seeking a church that will not bring politics into sermons." Some of you would feel the same way. "Especially praise and worship." And I'm going to tell you, I agree fully with that. Praise and worship's about God. It's not even about me. My wife and I have had these discussions. Too much of the worship out there is about me, 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 me. You know, oh, me, 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 me. I. It's not about you. We're not worshiping you, right? It's about he. That'll make you laugh, right? It's all about him. And so worship ought to be about him. It ought to not be about politics. It ought to be about Jesus. I'm with her right there. "Part of my main purpose in following Jesus is to show compassion to all." Me too. "I've left a church before because I felt they excluded certain groups of citizens and people." By the way, the church is for everyone. "The beautiful Jesus that I know is for everyone. I am seeking a church that does not espouse political or religious dogma. I also consider myself a seeking and cultivating peaceful experience with other humans, learning about such qualities as forgiveness, gentleness, cooperation. Can you please say if this sounds like someone who would fit there with you all? If either way is fine, I still greatly appreciate the way you celebrate faith in Christ, most respectfully," and I'm leaving it anonymous. I'm not upset that she sent the letter at all. In fact, I'm very thankful. And you might be sitting out there, I wouldn't know. If we had more time, I would give you my response. I'll be honest with you. It was late last night after working a very long day and then having to study for today. So I responded quickly. But my response is basically this, and I want you to know it, because if you're looking for a non-political church, you found it. This is it. We're biblical, not political. If we're not biblical, we got a problem. But listen, listen carefully. If we're going to be biblical, we have to set the tone for culture. If we're going to be biblical, we have to speak to the leaders and prophesy the word of God to the leaders of our community, of our state, and of our nation. Now, it's not about it would be good. It's not about it would be nice. It's what we have to do. I get this letter in the same day that I got an invitation to go and speak in Washington and to be able to meet with the Speaker of the House, because guess what? Our world, our nation needs the gospel message, and they cannot do their job and represent this country if they don't listen to what the people of God are saying, because it's our job to prophesy to the nations, and it is the devil's job to shut us up. And I'm telling you, don't align yourself with the devil that tries to shut up the word of God in any area of the world. Any area, arts, entertainment, politics. It is literally our, not mine, our responsibility, not just to vote, but to stand up and let the word of God, not your voice, the word of God to be heard. My voice doesn't matter. His voice matters. I want you to hear what I think means absolutely nothing. So parrot what God says. Your authority, which plays right into my message today, your authority is zero, but your authority in Christ is everything. So take the authority of the word of God and speak life to the nations. Speak life to your neighbors. Speak life, dads, to your children. Moms, to your children, to your husband, to your family. We need fathers to come back and be men of God. We need mothers to be women of God in their homes and in their communities. How does that play into baptism? Well, a whole lot. A whole lot. Now, can I get it out? We'll see. All right. There's a history of water. Now, I'm not a Scientologist. If you know what they believe, it's crazy. But, sorry, did I say that out loud? What I really meant to say was, they're nuts. And so, and what they believe is deceptive and wrong. So Scientology is weird, okay? And it's not biblical, so I've got to say that. So I want to play a quick video about water and about cleansing, but most of all, the history of baptism, and I want you to see some of the things that represent the washing away, the cleansing. Last week we talked about cleansing. Today it is about a cleansing confession, which is baptism. Let's watch this video.
Water holds the power of life and death. Without it, you cannot survive. Too much of it destroys. Early in the human story, water cleansed the earth of evil and wickedness. Only Noah and his family remained dry. Years later, an infant Moses, placed in a basket, is saved from death in the Nile River. Moses remains dry. And again, Moses leads his people across dry land, just before the Red Sea crashes over Pharaoh and his armies. In this water, we find death, our separation from God. Then Jesus comes. He does not avoid the water. He is immersed in it with us, baptized with humanity. He emerges with a new life, a new self, a new identity, and invites us to do the same. Water holds the power of life and death. Today, we choose life.
Amen. So I wanted to get some biblical history out about water because otherwise I'd be preaching on that forever. So the question today is this: in the authority of the name of Christ, that's what baptism really is about. It is about our confession with the authority of Christ. When we have faith in Christ and we make a confession of birth. So listen, I want to ask you, what defines you? Ask yourself, what defines me? What makes me who I am? You know what I love? I love that the fact that God gives us new life. He gives us a new day. He gives us a new week. He gives us a new year, a new decade, new centuries. God is about new, making things new. It's about giving us a clean slate. But what defines you? What defines last year? What defines last month? What defines last week for you? Is it your childhood that defines who you are today? Is it your marriage or maybe your divorce? I want to tell you that those things tried to define you. Your failures try to define you. And sad to say, too often, people, Christians, even churches, try to define you by your failure. Anyone ever live with that? family who tries to define you by your failure? How about you? Listen, you're your worst enemy. Do you try to define yourself, not meaning to, not wanting to, but through discouragement, depression, define you by what your darkest moment was, what your failure was? What defines you? Is it your friends that define you? Your acceptance, your social media, or your lack thereof? Is it your past or your problems, your failures? Maybe it's your children. I don't know about you, but it's kind of crazy. My children have become interesting in my world. It used to be I was Aaron, and then I became Pastor Aaron. And now I become Jet's dad, Haley's dad, Lauren's dad, Eva's dad, Maverick's dad. I'm going to tell you something, it's kind of crazy. I become dad and granddad more than I become Aaron. Maybe your sin. Maybe it's your addiction that defines you, or your sobriety defines you. You're more about your sobriety than you are anything else. I get sick of that. Because life's not all about sobriety, but I'll tell you what, without sobriety, you can really ruin your life. You see, I'm a Christian, folks. That bothers some, but I'm a Christian. I'm unashamed. I give you no apology. I'm a Christian. Sometimes I fail, but I'm a Christian. Sometimes I do it wrong. Sometimes I'm up here saying a lot. Sometimes I say it wrong. But I'm still a Christian. What defines me is Jesus. I'm born again of the Spirit of God, and I live in Christ. It's no longer I that lives, but Christ who lives in me. My hope is in Christ. My future is in Christ. You say, well, I don't know if that's healthy. Well, I'll tell you what, without Christ, everything I do is as filthy rags. My past, folks, is behind me. Every day, I put my past behind me. I'm not going to look back. I'm not going to live from yesterday. I'm going to live with a new day every day. My future is full. My hope is unending. And my promises are from Jesus. His mercies are new every morning. Every day I wake up as a new day. Jesus has forgiven me. Something I learned from a rabbi just recently. While I was in Israel, a conversation came up. And it's one I had also a year ago. The Jews believe that God forgives. And I want you to think for a moment, does Jesus forgive you? Yeah. But when Jesus forgives you, he forgives you of what you've done wrong, right? Jesus forgives you of your sins, right? That doesn't mean the people you've wronged have to forgive you. Now, as a believer, we forgive someone. Why? Well, because we realize that God forgave us. He didn't have to. I probably ought to forgive everyone else. But why do we expect people who are not believers to forgive us when we've wronged them? I'll be honest with you. Some of us need to learn to make amends. We have to make amends because we've wronged someone. We should make it right. Too often we act like, oh, God forgave us. In your face, who cares about you? I've wronged you. And people are going, wait a second. I'm glad God forgave you, but I'm still struggling with your problems. I'm still struggling with what you did to me. See, folks, we don't get to walk or fly our forgiveness and our Christianity in the face of others and wrong them and never say sorry and never make amends. Listen to Galatians 2:20. It says this, I have been crucified with Christ. That's what baptism is about, being buried with Christ. I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I that live. It's no longer me that lives. What defines me? Christ. Why? because he died to give me life. It's no longer I live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God. I live by trusting Jesus, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God. Now, it's not the mercy. The mercies are new every day. Mercy is when you don't get what you deserve. Grace is when you're given something you don't deserve. In other words, you have strength, power, and authority that you don't deserve. God gives you grace, not as if he overlooks sin, but he gives it to you as a gift that you can operate in the fruit and the power of the Holy Spirit every day because of what Jesus did. Now, that was a mouthful, but we're going to keep moving. Baptism, what is the reality? What is it really? Do I really need to be baptized? It's a question you should ask yourself. Do I really need to be baptized? Romans 5, 12, 12 through 21, but I'm not going to read it all. I'll read some of it. It says, therefore, just as through one man sin entered into the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men because of all have sinned. So every one of us have sinned. We were born a sinner. Here's the problem. And I know that you may feel like this is very surface. There's some deep pieces, but it is somewhat. Every couple of years, I feel it's important to really talk about baptism. Last month, we had a number of people baptized. This month, we've got a number more people being baptized. I would figure that next month, because we had a couple people accept the Lord even this morning, I would expect that next month or next week, we'll have even more people baptized. Why? Because it's important to be baptized, but then what are you going to do with it? From until the law was in the world, but sin is not imputed because there is no law. And I don't have time to really get deep into that, but listen to what it says. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those who had not sinned according to the likeness of the transgression of Adam, who is a type of him who came. But the free gift is not like the trespass or the offense. For if by one man's offense many died or were born dead, meaning this, your spirit is dead. Let me explain something. You are made up of a three-part being, just like God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but he's one God. You are a three-part being. Now listen carefully. When you are born, your spirit is dead in trespasses and sin. When you accept Christ, you are born again of the Spirit of God. All right? I am born again when I accept Christ, but I am being saved. What is that? My mind, my will, and my emotions. My soul man is being saved. My body or flesh is living, touching this world, needing cleansed, and I need to be led by either the flesh or the spirit. Galatians makes that clear. I'm going to be led by the spirit by choice. Otherwise, if I make no choice, I will be led by the flesh. You do nothing, you'll be led by the flesh. You choose to renew your mind daily. You choose to make godly choices. And when you don't, there's repentance needed. He goes on and says, for the judgment which comes from one's offense, this is verse 16, results in condemnation. But the free gift which came from many offenses results in justification. He's saying this, every one of us were born deserving to die. Listen to that, every one of us deserve death. None of us deserve to live, none. But God loved us so much that he justified us, made us as if we didn't sin when we accept his cleansing by the blood, by the water. And that's something I may or may not have time to get into next week. But here's what's important. We have a result. In verse 18, it says that resulting in justification of life, for just as one man's disobedience made all men sinners, we were all born in sin, a curse fell on every one of us. So also by one man's obedience, who is that? Jesus. made many righteous. Being able to stand before God righteous. So you didn't have to do anything to sin. You just were born. But God loved you so much, He didn't want to leave you that way. And I want to tell you today, folks, there is hope in every one of us. The baptism you'll see in just a few moments, I'm pretty excited about it. You know why? Because my son is getting baptized. This will be the sixth kid of mine that I get to baptize or be a part of. What does it mean to be buried with Christ? In Romans 6, and there's so much. In Romans 6, verse 3, do you not know that as many were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? You're being buried. For we were buried with him in baptism unto death, and just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. For if you were being united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we should also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Here's the beauty of this. God is saying this. He's saying we are buried with him in baptism, but it's not enough just to die. He wants to raise you to live the life he has called and ordained you to live. It's not enough to not sin. It's time to be obedient to the will and to the power and to the presence of God. It's time to really start living. Religion will bring death, but the life of Jesus Christ will cause you to start living. It is the resurrection life that matters. And does it happen? Does it dwell in you? I really want you to answer that. Does it dwell in you? It's not enough to know it all. We know so much. But do we live so much? I want you to ask yourself that. Do you live? Do you live the life he's given you? We have our children who I want them to live abundant lives. I want them to live far beyond me. I don't want them to live in sin. I don't want them to destroy themselves. I don't want them to cut off their future and their hope. I want them to live. Baptism is about being buried, putting the old man to death that the new man would come. At the end of this, he says, not only are you to be raised to live in Christ, that death would no longer have dominion over you. Likewise, you also consider, reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive unto God. In Christ Jesus, you are alive. And now your members, your body, the flesh that meant so much to destroy you, now becomes an instrument, a weapon of warfare out of obedience to Christ, that you get to defeat the enemy. You get to see souls saved. Everything that was gets turned around when you realize that I am led by his Spirit. I am being saved, mind, will, and emotions every day. And it is literally flipping this thing around. But it's up to you. I remember when I was a young man, a missionary coming to our church, and he talked about baptizing. I don't remember his name. I wish I could quote him. I wish I could tell you who he was. But he said, we got ready to baptize. And as we got ready to baptize, this young man looked into my eyes and he asked, he said, Pastor, are you really going to drown me? Because this young man thought he would put him under the water and wait until he was drowned and then raise him to new life. This is a symbol. This is a shadow. This is an example of being buried with Christ to raise to walk in newness of life. That's you today. What is our public declaration? Romans 10, you've heard me say it many times. If you confess the Lord with your mouth, the Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made. What is it about baptism is simply this. What is powerful about baptism is simply this. What is so powerful is this, is that you tap into the authority of Christ. Now, what do I mean by that? Wait one more minute and I'll tell you. The next thing is, it is a celebration of life. A celebration of living. This is your birthday. For you being baptized today, it's your birthday. Now, some of you will say, well, wait a second, I was born again a while back. Let me ask you a little question. How many of you have ever celebrated a birthday before? How many of you celebrate Conception Day? Mom and Daddy did, you don't. Now listen, some of you are born again, but it is the birth, it is the physical evidence of what has done in the heart that we celebrate today. It is the confession, not just what's done in your heart, but an outward confession to say, I'm going to begin to live in the authority and the forgiveness, and the old things are gone and the new things have come. And today is a new day, a new life that I'm about to live on my own in Christ. Amen. We got a Sealander baby about to pop. Next week, she's going to have a baby. It's going to come with great celebration. Today, it's a better celebration. It's a better celebration today than our physical birth. Our spiritual birth takes us now into eternity with God instead of torment without Him. 2 Corinthians 5 says this, therefore, if anyone is in Christ Jesus, he's a new creature. The old is gone and the new has come. Praise the Lord. God is reconciling man to himself. You see, the celebration is not just for what God does for you. It's not just for what God does in me, but it's what God does through me. I can be a father with what God does in me. I can be a husband with what God does in me. I can be a friend. I can save souls because of what God does in me. And I celebrate the authority of what God does in me. And if you'll read 2 Corinthians 5, you'll realize you become an ambassador. You become a reconciler. You have a ministry to change lives, a purpose to change lives. It starts at home and it should go around the world. Number three, in whose name, in whose authority are you being baptized? Okay, now we got some problems. The church likes to argue. Acts chapter 2 says this. In verse 38, it says, then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. What did he say? He said, be baptized in the name of Jesus. So what are we going to do today? We got a problem. Matthew 28, 18 says this. Actually, go to 19. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Okay, we got a problem. In fact, a problem that divides churches and people fight over and argue over. Are we going to baptize in the name of Jesus today and make it legit? Are we going to baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit and make it legit? Marlene, what are we doing? Matthew 28, let's turn to 18 instead of 19. I want you to see something powerful. And Jesus came and spoke to them saying, here's how he prefaced that. All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. You see, what happens in that tub, what happens in your life, what happens in your heart, your rebirth experience, your spirit that was dead in trespasses and sin, becoming alive unto God, what happens is in the authority of what Jesus did on the cross of Calvary for you and me, and what he did by breaking that tomb open that we celebrated last week. You see, it is the authority of Jesus. Now you say, should it be in Jesus or in the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost? Let me explain something to you. We don't serve three gods, we serve one. I'm a Trinitarian. I'm one man, but I got three parts. We don't serve three gods. Jesus has a spirit. It's called the Holy Spirit. God the Father has a spirit. It's called the Holy Spirit. There is the Word. And guess what his name is? Jesus. You see, he's manifested. He relates in many ways, but it's one God. And so it is by the authority of Jesus. I baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, who is, and by the authority of the name of Jesus. Folks, why? Because it's the right thing to do. If you got baptized wrong, don't let somebody freak you out. People argue over the craziest things. Should we sprinkle it or fully immerge? I don't know. Do you want to die with Christ or just be sprinkled by him? We put you all the way under. It's just what we do. Because I don't want a little bit of sprinkle of Jesus. I want the whole thing. I'm going to die. I don't die because I got hit with a sprinkler. I want to die and be raised to newness of life like Christ. It's not enough to get a little sprinkle of Jesus. I want fully immersed, and I want to fully die. I want this flesh to be done, and I want to become a man of God living in the authority of Jesus' name and by the Word of God. It's why it affects our politics. It's why it affects our family. It's why it should affect every corner of your life. I'll show you one more quick thing. Show the picture of a mikveh bath. You see this right here? I took this picture when I was in Israel. I took it in Magdala. They're all over the place. They're outside the temple. They're in the temple. They're on the way to the temple. Why? Because to go into the temple, you need to be refreshed or cleaned or baptized. John the Baptizer went and baptized. What was he doing? He was doing a mikveh ceremony. His was specific because it wasn't to go into the temple. It was to cleanse yourself because there was a coming Messiah and his name is Jesus. And he was preparing the way just like Elijah had prophetically done. He was playing the part of Elijah. I said a whole lot right there. All right, see this right here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 steps. You go into a mikveh this way. You take your first step on the right-hand side. You go in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. You then bathe yourself all the way under. Were they representing the baptism of Christ, being buried with Christ? No, they don't, because they don't believe in Jesus. But they were cleansing themselves ceremonially that they could come before God. Folks, thank God Jesus did that. You get to come before God cleansed and clean by the work of Christ on the cross of Calvary. Amen? And you're just saying to the whole world, hey, yesterday's gone and today's a new day. So it's 7 steps because of the 7 days of the week, kind of, but not really. It's 7 steps because it shows perfection coming in, and then coming out cleansed. And here's the deal. If you ever touched anything dead, if you come in contact with anything dead, you had to go and be cleansed. You know why? Because death should have no part in us. Because Jesus came and conquered death, hell, and the grave. I do not die any longer. I live. This physical body will die, but I will live forever and ever and ever. I did a funeral on Friday. It was a very difficult, very sad, very hard funeral. I want to tell you something. I will not be held by death. You do not have to be held by death. We can walk out full and complete when we go into that mikveh and when we come out. Amen? That's what John the Baptist was saying. That's what Jesus was saying. Number 4, what are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? Excuse me, what are you waiting for? The Apostle Paul had killed Christians. His life was about death. He thought it was about life until he contacted Jesus, got knocked off his horse, and realized that he was the King. He was the Lord. And he was blinded. But listen to what he says in Acts chapter 22. And now, why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. So wait a second. Does my baptism wash away my sins? No, listen. It's the authority of the name of Jesus that washes away my sins. And see, when I go into that tank, I publicly confess, I proclaim that Jesus is my Lord and my Savior. What are you waiting for, folks? Today, some of you need to accept Christ as your Savior. Some of you need to say, I'm signing up for baptism because I don't care who knows. I am not worried about being embarrassed because Jesus held himself on the cross with love for me, and he was not just nails. It was literally his love for you and me that held him there waiting. He was literally hanging on the cross because he loved you and I. It's not the water itself. It's the proclamation. It is your cleansing confession that Jesus is my Lord. There's an old song. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. Absolutely no turning back. Though none go with me, still I will follow. No turning back. My cross I'll carry. No turning back. Close your eyes for a minute. You can leave them open. You might need to read the words. Go ahead. It's all right. I have decided. Sing this. Today, have you decided? Doesn't matter who's going to go with you. Doesn't matter if your spouse or your children or who follows with you. Have you decided today that nothing is more important than following Jesus? Amen. Absolutely, I will not turn back. Have you really decided today? Have you made a decision that this is a new day? A day of mercy? That no matter what you deal with, no matter what or how difficult times get, no matter what storms come your way, you're going to carry the cross all the way until you see Christ. Amen. No turning back. Come on, say it like you mean it. No turning back. Yesterday is gone, folks. This is a new day in Christ. By the authority of the name of Jesus Christ, yesterday is gone. Don't let people hold you back. Don't let yourself hold you back, but confess Jesus as Lord and Savior, because today is a new day. No turning back. Absolutely no turning back. Praise the Lord. Let's say this with some power. No turning back. Come on. When you see it, come up. Come on. Praise your name. Father, we thank you. We thank you, God. Yes, Lord. By the authority of your name, with your grace and with your mercy. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
To follow Jesus, no turning back.
No turning back.
No turning back.
Amen. Stay standing. Could you stand to your feet with me? We're gonna stand. I'm gonna ask the prayer team to just step out for a moment. It's only gonna take us a moment or two. We're gonna do our baptisms, and my sons will be one of the first ones. I'm so excited for him. And I'm just gonna tell you, baptizing him is a privilege. I turn my focus now after him. I turn my focus to my grandchildren. I want to see them serve Jesus. I want to see them know they'll have to choose. They'll have to decide. I can't do it for them, but I can lead them. I can show them a way that'll make it worth it. That they'll see there's power in the name of Jesus. If you're here today, I'm not going to make this difficult. If you're here today and you're ready to say, I have decided. Oh, the past not been so great. You might be thinking, oh, if I could get things a little better, if I could get some things cleaned up, can I just tell you, you can't get things cleaned up. You need the power of the Holy Spirit. You need to start with saying, Jesus, I need your help. Start with saying, Jesus, I can't do this on my own. I need your help. And then as you accept Christ, he gets to empower you. Quit letting religion rule you. Quit letting thinking you need to gain it. You can't gain it. It's a free gift. So if you're here today, I'm going to have these people, they're here ready. They're ready. They want to pray with you. We're a little short-handed in our purple books. Too many people got saved the last year. I need 2,500 bucks. I want to buy another 500 of them. So, but here's the deal, guys. We got a few. And if you want one, we'll give it to you. If you want to accept Christ as your personal Lord and Savior today, would you just come out of where you're at and let's give our hearts to the Lord. If you have been turning back, but today you say, today's a new day. It is a new day for me. If it's you right now, get out of your seat. If you're ready to say, this is my day of salvation. Could you walk here? Amen. Anyone else? Come on. Come on. Step out from where you're at. No turning back. From this day forward is a new day. Amen? Anyone else? Anyone else? All right. Heavenly Father, I pray that, Father, each one that heard this message today, Lord, as simple as it was deep. It was deep because it's deep in the truth of your word. It's deep because it takes us from death unto life. It's deep because lives are changed, families are changed, communities are changed. Lord, the world gets turned upside down, really right side up because of what you are and what you do in us and through us. And Lord, I just ask that, Father, for everyone questioning themselves today, everyone wondering today, that this would be a new day in Christ Jesus. And Lord, for those that are about to be baptized, Lord, let them do so in the power of your resurrection, in the power of your word. And Lord, we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I just want to say, for those watching on television, you can go to our website. If you'd like to be baptized, folks, it's time you make this decision. If you wonder about rebaptism, if you wonder about any of those things, it's all in that. If you would, in about 2 minutes, we're going to begin our baptisms right over here to the right. Maverick, you have a testimony or anything you'd like to say?
I mean, like you said, and I've gotten kind of it by everyone my entire life. Why haven't you been baptized? Why is it taking so long? And, for a while I was just like, oh, well, I'll do it later. I'll do it later. I'll do it later. And then Eva got baptized, and my dad was like, why don't you get baptized soon? And I was like, well, I want to do it when it's, like, a little bit after Eva, so that it's, like, and then after I preached, I was like, I can't do this and talk about being a disciple and showing your, oh, I thought you were crying. Showing your faith in the Lord without doing it myself. And so I was like, I have to get baptized. I mean, I'm already planning on going into ministry. That's like my dream. And even having the hard decisions to do that, like the little things that someone would be like, that isn't going into that, would just be like, why would I do that? Why? There's no point. And doing stuff that gets you closer to that, even if it's hard at the moment. So that's kind of how I've been living my life lately, is I've been doing the hard things in order to...
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and by the authority of the name of Jesus, I now baptize you.
Do you have any testimony you would like to share, Virginia?
God was with me. Be with me all times.
Upon this public confession of your faith in Lord Jesus Christ, your determination to leave all and to follow him, I have the privilege of baptizing you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, in the authority of the name of Jesus.
Do you have a testimony you would like to share?
I don't know if I should touch that.
You're okay. You won't get shocked.
I just want to say that Jesus pulled me out of the trenches of addiction, brought me into his light, in his arms of grace and mercy. And I just want to be a warrior for him and share him with the work I do and rededicate my life to him.
Upon your public confession of faith, your determination to leave all, I have the privilege of baptizing you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, by the authority of the name of Jesus. I baptize you.
I just want to tell everybody out there that God works in mysterious ways. If you just open up your heart, he will be there for you.
Amen. Amen.
Upon this public confession of your faith, your determination to leave all and follow after Jesus, I have the privilege of baptizing you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And by the authority of the name of Jesus, I baptize you.
So a year ago, I had a stroke, and it's by the grace of God that I'm here today. And my kids, especially that Christopher, he stayed with me the whole time in the hospital. And he took me to his house and he made me do my work. So that's, I mean, I was paralyzed from this side. So yeah, I believe in Jesus Christ. He saved my life.
Amen. Amen.
Upon your public confession of faith, your determination to leave all and follow after Jesus, I have the privilege of baptizing you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. In the authority of the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Upon this public confession of your faith in the Lord Jesus, we get the privilege of baptizing you, but do you have a testimony?
Yes. I'm turning my whole life around. I used for most of my life, and I'm now sober, and it's been awesome. and I've been meeting a lot of good people, and I just have the Lord in my heart, and it's all different, and I just love it.
It makes all the difference. Yeah. Amen. Amen.
Upon this public confession of your faith, your determination to leave all, and sobriety is not your relationship with Jesus, but he will help you in your sobriety. Remember that. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, who is, and by the authority of Jesus Christ, we baptize you. Amen. Here we go.
But do you have anything you'd like to say?
I just hope that God is with me in my sobriety. This is my first time getting sober in my life. And it's a struggle for me, going through a lot of health problems. And so I need all the help I can get.
Upon this public confession of your faith, your determination to leave all and follow Jesus, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, by the authority of the name of Jesus. Amen. Have you decided to be baptized? More importantly, have you decided to put your complete faith and trust in Jesus Christ? Today, I want to tell you, it is a day of salvation. People, their lives are being changed. People are getting delivered from drugs. They're getting delivered from all kinds of addictions. We're seeing that right here at Crossfire Church. And for you that support us, I want to tell you, you're a part of that. For you who pray with us and pray for us, you're a part of that. For you who volunteer and participate, you're a part of that. It's beautiful to be a part of what God's doing. But I want to remind you, it is what God's doing. I remind you, it's what God is doing in the lives and hearts of people. And I'm just thankful to be able to help facilitate that and be a part of it and preach the gospel and be able to love people. And I'm thankful for many of you that helped make this happen. What a beautiful day it is to serve the Lord. If you are not serving the Lord today, if you do not know the Lord as your personal Lord and Savior, today is your day. Please call us at 541-686-FIRE. That's 541-686-FIRE. Give us a call today, or go check us out at our website where you can get all the information, hopefully, and how to contact us. We'd love to see you right here at a Crossfire service. And if you'd like to support what's happening in this ministry, you can do so by going to our website or our mailing address that's just about to come up, and you'll be able to be a part of what God's doing here. And we're so thankful for the changed lives. If you've never been baptized, I encourage you to call us. We'd love to talk with you about it. We'd love to give you the information of why and how and what does it mean to be baptized and begin to follow after and walk in discipleship. Thank you.
Crossfire World Outreach Ministries is supported by faithful monthly contributions from viewers like you. Please take time today and make your tax-deductible gift to Crossfire World Outreach Ministries, 942 28th Street, Springfield, Oregon 97477, 541-686-3473, or find us on the web at mycrossfire.com.